Yo, what's up? This is Patrick from Guy in the Cube, and in this video, I'm gonna talk all about streaming data flows. What are they? How do I use them? Why do I use them? Stay tuned. If you find this for the very first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date on all the videos from Adam and this guy. Okay, someone asked a question on our live stream. They're like, hey guys, what do you think of streaming data flows? And you guys know Adam and I like to talk a lot. And it was like, crickets. Because neither one of us had ever kicked the tires on streaming data flows. And so we had to go and give it a try. Before we did that, I reached out to my good buddy, Krish. He's a PM. He owns Streaming Dataflows at Microsoft, and he dropped some serious knowledge. Big shout out to Krish. Thank you so much for the time that you spent with us. And as soon as we head up to Redmond, we're gonna do a video with Krish so we can really dig deep into these things. So what are these streaming data flows? Basically, if you have a large volume of data or some data that's moving at extreme velocity, it'll help you analyze that data in real time. Not fake real time, real time. What's the difference, Patrick? One's fake and one. Anyway, once we got that knowledge, it was like, all right, so now guess what? You guys know how I like to do? Instead of all this talking, let's head over to my laptop. Head over to Power BI. I know you guys noticed this. You do need premium or premium per user to set up streaming data flows. Once you have a workspace that's backed by premium or premium per user, you go here and you click new. If you've already created a streaming data flow, then regular data flows that we've been using forever will be disabled. You can only have one type of data flow per workspace. You can either have streaming data flows or regular data flows. Then what you do is choose streaming data flow. We're gonna give it a name, click create. There we go. Now, immediately, I noticed that we have three sources, Event Hubs, IoT Hubs, and Azure Blob Store. I didn't have it either. So I went over to Teams because I know someone. Her name is Hope Foley. Hope works with all these different types of technologies in Azure. And I was like, hey, Hope, you ever done anything with Event Hubs? Because I decided I wanted to use Event Hubs. They look like the simplest and easiest route to go. And she was like, yeah. I was like, well, I'm thinking about writing a console app in C# to simulate some stream data. So I had this idea. I own this little ice cream truck company where we deliver ice cream all over my little town and have these IoT, these sensors that sends information back to track the temperature in my refrigerated trucks, because it needs to be between a certain temperature, else my ice cream is going to start to melt or it's going to start to freeze. And then I can see a roll in her eyes. She's like, why would you write a console app with C#? I'm like, because that's what I know how to do. She's like, no, Patrick, look at your chat. And she had uploaded a PowerShell script. Just use that. So we jumped on a video chat and she said, just replace a couple of variables and press play. And that's what I did. I customized it a little bit, start streaming my data. Thank you so much, Hope, for all the help. All right, back to my laptop. So once I got that done, I created my Event Hub because I needed some things from the Event Hub to get the PowerShell script running. So the first thing you're going to create is this namespace. And then after you create your namespace, you're going to create the Event Hubs. And then what you're going to need to set up your streaming data flow is a connection string. On the namespace, you can actually go get the connection string by choosing shared access policies and going to the default policy, and you'll see a connection string here. Do not use this connection string. You want to use the connection string from the policy that you create in your Event Hub. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Over back on the overview page for the Event Hub's namespace, you go down and you just click a plus and create your Event Hub. Once the Event Hub is created, you click it and then you'll see your shared access policies and you'll need to create one. And once you create it, you will simply click here and grab the connection string. Let me show you the difference. This is the connection string at the namespace level and this is the one at the Event Hub level. The one at the Event Hub level has an entity path specified at the end where the one from the namespace does not. This is the one you want and I'm gonna show you why when we head back over to the Dataflow editor. Now you need to choose your source. So I'm going to go ahead and choose Event Hub. And then I'm going to pop in the connection string from the namespace. Watch this. See how the connect button never lights up? That's because we're missing that entity path. So now I'm going to grab the connection string from the Event Hub itself. There we go. The consumer group, you can actually change the name. We're going to accept default. Go ahead and choose connect and then choose auto detect. And then it'll auto detect your fields. When I was constructing my PowerShell to send the body, the event over to Event Hubs, you need to make sure that your JSON is well formed. And there's lots of websites out there that'll help you validate the JSON and things like that. But you need to make sure it's well formed. If it's not, in the editor, you'll get a little warning sign that says an error and you hover over and it'll tell you, hey, your JSON is not well formed. And now you may be thinking, man, look, I got a little error. But if you look at the bottom, you should see data streaming in real time. Once you do this, you can actually go and use some aggregations. You can set up some windowing. You can do lots of different things. For me right now, I just want to make this data available in Power BI Desktop. So you need to create an output table and link the event hub to the output table. And then we need to specify a name. So we're gonna call this truck temp video 2. And then you click save. Once I click save, everything will be ready to go. If I go back and click here, you'll see data popping in. Eventually you see how it's coming in real time. So then I'm gonna go back out to my workspace and go to settings, because you can set the retention duration. You can maintain up to 7 days of real-time data. No more than 7 days, all the way down to a day. In my case, I'm only concerned about what's happening with my temperatures on my ice cream truck today. Yesterday doesn't matter to me because that's already happened. So we set this to 1 and click apply, and then head back to the workspace. And then you just need to start it up. Once it's started up, you're gonna head over to Power BI Desktop, choose Get Data, click More, go to the Power Platform. And here's another thing. You're gonna see Power BI Dataflows and Dataflows. Do not choose Power BI Dataflows, choose Dataflows. Adam published a video that talks about the difference between the two. You should go watch that video if you wanna know why, right? I'm not gonna get into that here. So go ahead and choose Dataflows, click Connect, and then a little dialog window, it's gonna connect up. If you're not logged into your Power BI tenant, you need to log in. And then go look for your workspace. You can see here's my insane, amazing workspace. And then you can see my dev right here. You're gonna see a hot and a cold path. The hot path is actually the streaming data. So when you connect to that, when you're getting an option for import or direct query, if you want to capture this data in real time, you should use direct query. The cold path is everything outside that retention duration. I'm only capturing today. So everything else besides today will be in the cold path. And you can use that to do analysis and aggregations of the data. For me right now, I only care about the hot path. I'm gonna walk through all this, but like a cooking show, watch this. I've created this beautiful report that's gonna help me track the temperatures of the refrigerator trucks. I'm gonna click on the page and turn on automatic page refresh, and I'm gonna tell it to refresh every 5 seconds. So let's get some data streaming and let's see what's going on with my trucks out there as my two guys are delivering the ice cream. Oh, and now you see that my ice cream's melting. It went from a nice cone to melting. I get a notification right here. This number's turned red. And then if I click here and go check the temperatures, you can see that truck one is above 45 degrees. And I'm capturing all of this information in real time. I know this is simulation, but imagine, think of the art of the possible, what you can do with this. I have a power automate button on my report. I click that button, it'll email the driver. If I can create a dashboard, put that card on the dashboard, have it send out an alert. So many things I can do. What do you guys think? You ain't questions, you ain't comments? Have you used Streaming Dataflows? Well, this was our unboxing. I gotta tell you, I'm pretty impressed. Thanks, Hope. Thank Chris for all your help on this video. And if you guys have any questions, comments, let's continue the conversation where? In the comments below. If it's your first time visiting the Guy in the Cube channel, hit that subscribe button. If you like my video, big thumbs up. As always, from Adam and myself, thanks for watching. See you in the next video.